Look at its eyes and those teeth. Tentacle, tentacle, primordial, primordial. I say, all the way over there. It may be big, ugly, and a spawn of a god, but I bet my feathers it bleeds like anything else. And Manaha's like instantly turn on. Palagino said that. I say, like the other thing in the caverns underneath the mines in Stalwart. Once we defeated that thing, all the tentacles went away. Plus we fought enough tentacles. I think just try to fight this thing. It's immune to charm, confuse, and dominate it. Okay, we won't try to do that then.
Maybe big.
Alright.
Yeah, the spawn of the gold. And I bet.
Where is it? It's over here.
My feathers, it bleeds like
any. Unfortunately, I have to get through all this crap first. Don't. Why are we fighting the tentacles? Dragon strike, fly on top of it. That's the last thing I'd want to do, right? No combat music here? I know, I've barely been using her, you know, her powers. Wilting wind.
I'm ready.
There's our song. How much did the wilting wind do? -67 damage? Oh, it's weakened too? Yeah, why not? Hit it again. I know it's already weakened, but that's some pretty good amount of damage for something that huge. It's so funny because of the... we can barely see the radius around here. Okay, he's casting that. Oh my god. This thing's tearing my frickin' monitor apart. Is he still going? He's still going. He probably got interrupted. You are my sworn enemy. Barbaric shout. Oh, now these things? It's badly injured. Let's just kill this first. What? We killed it? We gained a Kraken eye. Theodos killed the Kraken. It went from badly injured, it wasn't even to like, you know, near death or something. Okay. Well, all the tentacles are gone, I was right. Now we can fight these things. Which, they're just eyeless hammers. Shouldn't be that bad. I don't know if they get terrified, but we'll try. Armor of Faith. We can get over to it, right? Then knock it down. Oh god. She's down, isn't she? Yeah, she needs to help them. Revive again. I always forget what this resurrection. She has a lot of focus here. We need to get rid of this thing. This is interesting. It kind of hurts her, but it's alright. Oh wow. Down, okay. Who are you, were you gonna hit again? Cool. Awesome music. Like it. Let's go into sneak just in case there's more of these things. Okay, so we gained an item. I think it's a quest item. The Eye of the Kraken. Release the Kraken! Is that a crystal? Something that kind of looks like an eye. I don't see. Maybe it's... Ooh. Did we have this before? Robes of the Tidebringer? Yeah, we had that. We got traps, I don't need those. Where's this eye? I'm gonna save as a new game. Because I'm not sure. I mean, hopefully we weren't supposed to lead those to the thing. We haven't found it yet. Up to like 43. Actually, we're up to like 46 or 7 now. Trying to look to see what... I wouldn't even know. Nope, it's scrolled off. I want to look at this thing, this eye. Where the hell is it? I'm pretty sure we're all filled up, so it wouldn't go in anyone's, you know, inventory. I guess it's... It would only get thrown in stash if it was a... A quest item. Oh, Order of the White March. What else? This book is a quest item? Oh, here it is. Kraken Eye. Huge and alien, this eye was taken from the corpse of Andra's Leviathan in the heart of Karen's scar. Even after the creature's death, the eye still holds tremendous magical power. Well, for what? I don't think we can use it for anything. I mean, maybe to make something? Alchemy, possibly? Alright, now can we look this thing up here? It'd be interesting to see. The Kraken. Here it is. Sailors all over Eora tell stories of the beast that haunt the deep. Of these, few are more feared than the Kraken. Krakens rarely venture to the surface, and they almost never leave survivors in their wake. They are massive, tentacled beasts capable of crushing small ships and plucking sailors from their decks. Despite their size, Krakens' soft, flexible bodies allow them to squeeze through tight spaces in search of prey or shelter. Thankfully, they prefer dark, quiet spaces to open water. They are cunning hunters and, according to legend, Andra's terrible servants. Well, sorry we had to kill your servant. Sorry, not sorry. Some stuff. What the hell's that? Oh, you're playing the song again? I'm like, what the hell? Oh, crystal. Okay. So there's the rest of the zone.
Got it.
Can we find anything else down here? Huh. It's like we can get back up. It's weird. I just want to look around everything else first. Before we even get near this crystal. Can't walk through there. Weird, he can't walk here. There's some odd stuff going on here. Okay. I guess it's too deep in these in this section. So yeah, we all went down, not just... Yeah. An enormous crystal juts from the wall like a spearhead protruding from a wound. An army of reflections stares back at you from the crystal's perfect facets. It echoes the sound of your footsteps in soft, ringing hums. Someone will have to take up Abaddon's hammer and strike the crystal, and Andra warned that whoever does so will be buried in this place with the eyeless. Whom do you choose? Oh, we could draw lots if we want to. Or we can consider further, which will just bring us out. Sorry, Maneha. She was out of anybody. Well, she's the only one who stepped forward. So, yeah, we'll bring Kanna back in the group. That sucks, though. I don't want to sacrifice her still, but... Oh, what? Run back and grab the grieving mother. Maneha? All is silent as you approach, Maneha.
When I became a gift-bearer, I never figured it'd be my own corpse I left in Andra's depths. Still, it'll be good to do something I don't regret.
Wow. Mineha hefts the hammer and swings it at the crystal. A perfect, clear tone rings through the air and resonates through your teeth. Seconds later, ripples shiver through the water. Something big is coming. Mineha lifts the hammer again and gives you a final nod. You scramble out of the flooded cavern and flee through the tunnels. Mineha continues hammering at the crystal, each strike magnifying the last. The echoes build into physical tremors. Meanwhile, a heavier rhythm pulses through the cave. Footsteps. Dozens of them. You round a corner only to see a line of eyeless advancing. The creatures stagger to the rhythm of the hammer thuds below, yet they crane their necks toward you, ratcheting back their piston arms. Huh. I don't even know what repulsing seal is. Cast ringleader? Well, I can take control of one of them. Aren't they immune to charm? Cast... I want to see what this is, actually. Cast repulsing seal. I'll choose this one. Consider who will cast it. Can I go back? There's no option to go back. Durance? A glowing seal blooms from the ground. The first two eyeless step onto it and fall backwards, taking most of the others with them. Haha, cool. Dodge past the eyeless. You sprint past the distracted monsters. Fortunately, the creatures are too focused on the hammering to give chase. They continue toward the cavern. Mineha maintains a steady tempo on the crystal. Eyeless gather in the cavern, where they batter the walls in time with the hammer's rhythmic blows. The ground shakes, falling rocks and shattering crystals splash to the ground. You flee through dark, rumbling corridors. More spellbound eyeless shamble along, but they're too entranced by the swelling cadence to take more than an idle swipe at you. The tunnel narrows, light filters through ahead. The exit must be around the next bend, but it's clogged with rubble. Meanwhile, the ground drops several feet at once, and a tunnel begins rolling on its axis. The distant sound of rushing water echoes from the cavern. We don't have twin stones or frenzy. Lever the rubble with the pry bar. There must be a weak spot, but it will take a practiced eye to find it. Who will clear the way? I don't know. Pelagina? Pelagina wedges the pry bar into several different nooks, but can't seem to find a leverage point. There must be a weak spot, blah blah blah. Adair. Nope. Me. Aloth? Durance? Oh, we need mechanics for it. I thought it was like a perception check or something. Durance notices a loose boulder and wedges the pry bar beneath it. A gentle nudge knocks it loose and it sends the rubble rolling away. Thank God we had someone with that deception 7. I mean, mechanic 7. The moon shudders again. You escape onto the ice just as another thunderous crash sounds from below. Eyeless continue pouring into the cavern from every visible tunnel and crevice. Mineha's ears ring at the ever-glowing cacophony of smashing rock and shattering crystal. Meanwhile, the water level is rising. A skull-splitting crack rends the air, and a surge of water knocks Mineha from her feet. The entire cavern rotates, plunging Mineha into a freezing soup of jagged metal, torn flesh, and stone. That's a horrible way to go. You dash across the lake. The ice squeals and crackles, rocking dangerously underfoot. The sinking moon groans. Long fissures race across the ice. Would this work for that? Cast Kalakoth's freezing rake to hold the ice together. Can consider who will cast it. Well, it's gotta be Aeloth. A spectral hand sweeps the ice in front of Aeloth. The ice sheets knit back together, holding just long enough for a safe crossing. It's pretty cool using these spells during, scripted, you know, kind of, well, they are kind of scripted scenes, I don't know. At last, you reach the safety of the shore. In the middle of the lake, only the tip of the moon is visible above the ice. You watch in silence as it sinks into the depths. The world seems to be falling apart in slow motion. Mineha sinks into the lake alongside the dark shapes of moon fragments and crushed eyeless. Mineha's lungs burn. Sparks flicker across Mineha's vision. Not sparks. Scales. What? Lagufath gather in front of Mineha, who notices something unusual in their iridescent eyes. A flicker of uncommon intelligence. Mineha hears a whisper.
You freed us from our prison in Durgan's battery. Consider our debt repaid.
The Lagufath, possessed by the spirits of Manun, or Marun, and the other Pergrunin, swarm and rush Mineha to the surface. Oh, yay! At last, Mineha reaches the shallows. She punches through a thin crust of ice and crawls ashore, trembling but alive. Hooray! Now she's so friggin' freezing, Aeloth will cast a fireball on her. You stand at the edge of the lake. The bobbing of the ice and the rippling of the water's surface slows until you're looking at a moment frozen in time. When the world begins moving once more, it moves in reverse. Really? The surface of the water churns and roils like it's about to spew something up. And it does. The fragment of Aeoni Brather rises, unbroken. Ice reforms across the surface of the lake, spreading in long, freezing fingers. Eyeless file out of the moon fragment and onto the ice. They wind around the moon in an ever-widening spiral. How's all this going on? They stop as the head of their line reaches you. They speak in a single voice that resonates with grinding metal and hissing steam.
We shatter and sink, discarded like worn tools. Why have you consigned us to oblivion?
Theodas. You would have destroyed Cadnua, Jurgen's battery, and more. Their protest is as sharp as squealing metal. You wouldn't have?
Blasphemy! These are jewels of civilization. They are sacred.
Then why would you destroy them?
We would sooner sacrifice our own bodies than dislodge a single stone from such a place. Why do you torment us with baseless accusations?
I like their voices, but they don't sound like twisted metal to me. Who else could have done such damage to a mighty Pargrin fortress? The eyeless are still, but you hear their gears whir as their collective spirit ponders this.
Then we were betrayed.
No. You were adapted to serve a new purpose. Oh my. Calm down there, big guy. The creature nearest you smashes its club fist into the ice, roaring in protest. And then we all sink down the bottom of the lake. And the intelligent Lagofath have to, you know, help us again.
And what if we adapted your flimsy hands with iron claws? Your brittle bones with mighty steel?
Another eyeless brandishes a sickle as tall as you.
A part of ourselves was cut away.
Theodas.
And we were made to betray something we cherish.
You feel their bitter agony like a hammer strike. I want to hear them say it. What was that?
The bedrock of civilization.
Suddenly, they attack the ice beneath them, slicing and shattering it with mighty swings from their iron arms. and where the ice breaks, ancient towers rise, blotting out the blue sky and white peaks. Those are in Gwythyn.
Each culture builds on the bones of the last. Yet many only look up at where they would go, never down at the foundations that bear them. Like a mason who builds a listing tower.
The remaining ice sheet cracks and groans.
What peril do they inflict on their progeny? And what dishonor on their forebears?
You hear the strain of crumbling stone in the voice of the eyeless. The betrayal of memory upsets you, greatly.
It is accepting a gift only to spit in the face of the giver. Every advance in the crafts and institutions of Kith was forged by skill and sacrifice.
You feel these words, and the anger behind them, in your bones.
A people cut off from their history will wither, and they deserve no less.
I don't agree, but what do you suggest?
To pull the blinders from the eyes of gods and Kith. That is why we must return to ourself and restore Abidan.
Huh. What do you mean about returning to yourself?
When Ioni Brotha fell, Abidan lost much. His will to preserve, the memory of how and why he died. But he built us with fragments of his own soul. In returning, we can restore what was taken from him.
You speak as if history were a guide. Yet it doesn't always provide a good example.
Then do not look to it for one. History is not a moral force, but a set of facts. These facts show Kith where they have come from, and how to move forward.
The Dear Woodens and Glamfellens have fought two wars over their history, and they still haven't moved forward.
But the memory of those wars has likely saved them from another now, when it would shatter a barren Deerwood.
I hear birds, but I'm not sure if it's outside my window or in the game, guys. Doesn't make sense for it to be in the game right now, but could be. It doesn't take a war to shatter a nation. Already, Deerwood's neighbors conspire to strangle it through duplicitous trade agreements. Right, Pelagina?
To kill.
All she said is to kill. Ack, in the Republics we call it the Golden Sword. It doesn't need to be bloodied to kill.
And you think it is grievance, and not merely opportunity, behind this treachery?
The souls seem to debate this question with one another.
Maybe so. But we would not cast history aside over one such example.
Starward and the Iron Flail remained at odds even in the face of a bigger threat, all because of their history.
The problem is not that they remember too much of their history, but rather too little.
The ice underfoot becomes suddenly clear. Between your boots you see an ocean separating Adir and the Eastern Reach.
Raid Sarans and Deerwoodens alike began as pioneers from Adir. They all came seeking opportunity.
Boats as small as ants crawl along the glassy blue.
Were they to look farther back, they would see their common origins and desires.
The ice dulls and thickens once more. but the experience of history is subjective. People remember what feels immediate and personal, just as you remember your own betrayal.
A painful truth.
They pause, recalling their suffering. You feel it radiate from them like heat.
We admit that history can become a hindrance. Even so, we must restore Abaddon.
Do we want them to restore Abaddon? Is that a good or a bad thing? I'm not sure what the ramifications of all this. Very well, return to yourself and be the god of preservation once more.
We shall see this world and its people restored.
A great wind shoves at your back, your ears pop, and you feel for a moment as if all of the air is being sucked from the sky. Suddenly, it ends and you are standing in the snow, looking over Karen's scar.
The Eyeless disappeared beneath the lake, their bond to Andra finally severed. With this threat ended, hope returned to the White March. Hunters returned to the wildernesses, and travelers to the roads. Tales of the Watcher's bravery replaced stories of monsters in the woods. The villagers of Stalwart busied their hands with work and their tongues with song, eager to seize on the promise of peace.
Cool. I reached the crystal at the bottom of the Eonibrother fragment and struck it with Abaddon's hammer. I escaped the lair of the Eyeless, and as they died, their souls left their bodies. I was able to speak with them. They are fragments of the soul of Abaddon himself. I decided to allow them to return to their master, so that he might remember the past, and that he was once the god of preservation.